does a wide variety of things. I won't get into the sales pitch, but if anybody's interested in asking me questions about Jetpack or learning more about it, please feel free to contact me afterwards. Jetpack's team is getting larger. This is most of us. We're now at like 60-something people. As I said, you can follow me on Twitter. Here are some books that I've written in the past years. I'm in the process of writing another one. It's actually building on a lot of the topics that we're going to be talking about today. And so we're going to cover six main things today to talk about: personalization, understanding your users, profiling them, providing them with the things that they want. And the first thing is about deep knowledge. But before we do that, I just met Stanley. He's dictating, or I'm dictating. I'm curious, so you write everything I say? So you would write, "I'm the greatest typer of all time"? How would you sell Jetpack? Yeah, that kind of would be. All right, for WordPress. Nice. All right, good. You would spell things like F, U, N, dirty minds. Okay. All right, just want to have a little understanding of things in this story. Alright, let's talk about how people get to your website. Here's an ad for the car dealership that I go to frequently for a new Civic. Pretty simple, you probably did some kind of search, right? And you end up landing on a page like this. And there's a Civic, I think, or a Ford. And then what's next? You're starting to look for Civics, you're interested in Civics. So, I can't really tell, but I moved my mouse over to the Honda Civic there in the bottom corner. It says 344 in stock. I love this because it's giving me actual, real information about the things that I'm interested in. And when I click that, I get to see all the Civics. This is cool. One thing that they do that I was really inspired by, something I thought was super cool, is that their home page now, at this point, the link at the top, which we have all classified as the home page, is that URL that you see very, very high up there. And it's the new inventory, and it's declaring the Civic, the year, all that stuff. So essentially, it's tracking what I'm doing as I'm moving through the site. This is so easy. This is like the most bare bones, fundamentally simple way of doing some tracking. Something that everybody in this room can do. So if you want to get complex, you want to be like Netflix and Amazon and do all these really super complex things with cookies and logins and all that stuff, you can do that. You might have to hire a developer or something like that. But they're just simply appending parameters to the end of the URL so that every single time I click something, it's continually grabbing that information and carrying it onto the next page. So it's like the poor man's, poor person's, it's like a rudimentary way to personalize a site, right? Anyways, I just saw this and I thought it was super cool, and I got to thinking about what we can do with that afterwards. Why not cookie the site? Take all those parameters and just drop a cookie. You can protect it and keep it safe for that user. That way, when they return to the site, you're not showing them SPDs necessarily, you're showing them Civics. This is, again, a very simple way to gain deep knowledge about your users and then throw it back at them. I'll give you an example of the site that I like to pick on that does do this well. This is the JCPenney homepage. It actually looks like the type of thing you would get in the mail, right? Like a flyer. The funny thing is, I've purchased stuff from JCPenney before. I've been to the site, I've logged in, and I've purchased big and tall men's clothing. Why is it so prominently showing me women's apparel, jeans, jewelry, things like that? I have to click through this site. I have to go deep into it. I have to go to the men's section, and I have to go to the big and tall section. And then I have to find this area. Why isn't this my homepage? I've purchased something from you. Why aren't you showing me this every single time I example, I purchased, no, I didn't really purchase this thing, this is a $55 shirt. I don't know why anybody would want a shirt that's not playing. But let's say I purchased this shirt, and then I come back in a week, and this is what the whole page looks like again. It's like I shake your hand at this conference, I meet you, I talk to you, I learn your name, I get to talking about what it is that you do, and then later at the after party, I'm like, it's nice to meet you, I've never met you before. Now, bear with me, that might happen at the after party. It's a lot. But my point is what kind of an experience does it make when I actually do remember your name, and I say I'm excited to see you when I buy you a beer at the after party, right? It's a completely different experience for you. So that's an opportunity that you have to continue that with your users and make sure that they understand that you care enough about them to learn about them and give it back to them. So number one, deep knowledge. Think about how you can start to integrate these things into the sites that you build. All right, next thing, consumption. How are people consuming your content? This is an example I've given in the past. Everybody understands exactly what we're looking at. No context, what is that?
Inbox.
An inbox, right. What's the blue dot?
You haven't read it yet.
I haven't read it yet. Exactly. This blue dot is magical. So whether or not they've come from your RSS feed, they've come from some tool that aggregates your content out, they've arrived through ads or whatever it might be, why aren't we keeping better track of things that people have consumed? So if it's a blog post, it's probably unlikely that they're going to read it multiple times over and over and over again. So why not mark it red? But if it's a different type of site, if it's the type of site where you need someone to purchase something, buy something from you, convert, and they haven't done that yet, you should be remembering it in the same way so that they can, you can present it back to them and teach them a little bit more about that thing each time they arrive, to help them arrive and make that decision to purchase from them. Now, blue dot is kind of powerful too, because isn't that suddenly like less anxiety for them? That thing is gone. It's there, it's like, oh, I got something to do. Now I deserve a beer because I got rid of it. And it's back again. It keeps happening over and over again. It gives you your users a task. It gives your users something to engage with your website, to almost gamify your site in the sense that they have the ability to take control of the content that they're reading. And then you can start to reorganize your content and talk about those related posts and things like that. So there's no reason you can't take all the things that they've read and prioritize them, either, like I said, based off of whether it's important that they see it again, or bury it because they've already read it and it's not as important for them to see it a second time. Maybe you want to surface something up from a lower part of your site or somewhere else where people haven't traveled to yet. And now they're back. They're giving you that opportunity show them that there's a reason for them to become a loyal visitor of your site. You shouldn't be just showing them the same exact thing over and over and over again, especially if you're someone like me who blogs like once a month. When it comes to consuming, the other thing that you can start to think about, and this is a plugin that I haven't actually had much time to test yet, but I saw it has pretty good reviews. This thing's pretty simple. It analyzes the length of time it would take for your site to be read by a normal reader and puts that time at the top or in near the excerpt or something like that. So now you're giving users more information. You're helping them to understand that this is a 7,000 word article. Maybe you should see it for later. Here's another plugin that allows users to bookmark content in WordPress so that when they return, you can present that information to them again. So if they're a fan of your site, and they haven't had a chance to read everything. Bookmarking is a great way or a great opportunity for them to come back and then be presented with a list of things that they need to catch up on. So when I see a 5-minute read or a 10-minute read, and I know I don't have time right now, but I'm about to get on the train, maybe I bookmark it and I come back and I see it later.
Now we have to log in to be able to get to.
And so this is a good question. The question was, do you have to log in to be able to see that? This exact plugin actually doesn't require you to have a login. So it'll do it with cookies. So it'll keep track of who you are based off of that. The next thing next thing this brings me to, yeah.
Right. Use that for voice work, let's say.
Brings it for what?
WebPress course content.
Oh, yeah, I mean, I think that would be absolutely great. Course content is a good example, you know, a very linear way in which you travel through content. So, you know, most LMSs, like Sensei, for example, will help you to understand the things that you've read and how far you've gone through a course. But again, if you want to create a rudimentary, this is like the sixth post you need to read to be able to understand the rest of my blog. Like, if you're Neil deGrasse Tyson, you're writing about complex physics, whatever, you want to have a learn-up previous to it, that would be a very cool way to, like, something to do so they can level up in your blog. I always want to mention accessibility because when we care deeply about accessibility, we actually provide better experiences for everybody. So when we're thinking about consuming content, we should be thinking about everyone consuming your content. You should be thinking about speed and performance. You should be thinking about you know, people who are hard to see. You have streaming media, who are hard of hearing, the list goes on. But when you care deeply about accessibility, it forces you to provide an experience that's far superior. And it's a good opportunity to actually stand out ahead of your competitors as well. Cool. So, deep knowledge, consumption. I know I'm moving a little quickly, but I also want to leave time at the end, and we still have four more to go. Next thing, where are your users? This is one of my favorite ways to personalize an experience for a customer. If you come in here, either have a client, run a website, or own their own brick and mortar physical location in the store, and you can manage it for a customer or where you are that customer. Okay, so a good portion of you. How important are local listings, local searches? Do you guys know that like something like 80% of people who, before they walk into a store now, will search for that store on Google? It's an astronomical number. I mean, it's such a large percentage of people who are going to go to the internet and learn something about your store before they ever actually set foot. And it can be something as simple as giving me the hours, the location, the direction, the directions, all that stuff. But why not take it a step further? So, here's an example of a Greek restaurant in downtown Manhattan. I love using Manhattan or Boston or, you know, really city-centric locations because you can do a lot of fun things when you're trying to get people to your location. Because there's a lot of competitors that are going to walk by. If I'm looking for a restaurant in downtown Boston or Manhattan or wherever, and I decide on going to this location, I'm probably still going to walk past like seven other restaurants on my way to this location. So how do you capture that person in that moment when they're starting to look at you and your company and make sure that they come and they actually arrive at your location? So first things first, providing a good mobile experience because this is how you consume their content now. They're on mobile devices. They're on some kind of old tablets and phones. So this website does a good job. Gives me some basic understanding of everything that's going on, and I appreciate the fact that you have a wonderful design. Let's take a step further. Now, I crushed their wonderful design with my terrible wireframe app. But how cool would it be if that location, if that restaurant said, look how close you are. Come in for a free appetizer. That is something that we can do right now today. You can use your browser location, or you can use IQ ranges and other things to determine where that user is and compare that to something you already know, which is your address. I hope you know where you are. And show them and just be explicit. Now, here's the thing. Don't do this if they're 6,000 miles away from you. It's pretty pointless. And you know, what you could do is a little bit different. Like, if you're a restaurant in California and I'm looking at your restaurant website and I'm in New York City, you could present something to me like, are you thinking about coming to California soon? We'd love to have you. And do something a little bit different. But for this example, look how close you are. You can even take it a step further. Tell them exactly how close they are and how to get to you. Yes, I know, I'm probably going to leave and go to next step? What if you tie it to some reservation app API, which, you know, how many people who own or work on a restaurant website have looked at, what's the name of those things, reservations?
OpenTable.
Yeah, all those, right? They have APIs that allow you to do this. So you can easily tell them, it's 9 minutes away, you have a 10-minute wait, should we reserve a table for you so that it's sitting there and waiting for you? On top of that, that free appetizer, you can give them the opportunity to choose the appetizer. Now, not only are they on their way, they have a table waiting for them, but their food will be hot and fresh and sitting on the table waiting for them when they get there. What an amazing experience that would be. Now, this is like, you know, the shooting for the moon, right? This is like the coolest thing that we could probably come up with at this exact moment in time. We're all like, that's pretty awesome. But you don't have to take it this far. Like, just simply telling people, giving them information about who you are, what you do, showing them that you care enough. That's important. All right. Next one. Chapter 4. Low cost. How many people have had this happen to their content? I don't have any chance to get this visitor onto my site now. Because you've taken everything I've written and you put it on Google, and now this user has no idea. Not that I don't want to go to the DMV.org website, but I'm not really attributing that content to anybody, right? Like, Google's now answered the question for me. This is something that you can either choose to fight, or you can choose to embrace it. The reality of the situation is that we all need Google to survive at some level. This is going to happen to you. If it does happen to you, it means that you've organized your content in a good way, and that people can understand it, and people can read it. So, just a quick tip, try not to fight this too hard. I talk to a lot of people who get very angry and upset about this. But you know, it is what it is. But when we're talking about finishing quickly, this is basically what we're saying. This is an opportunity for you to give your user exactly what it is that they want. And maybe in this case, you have to give up that visit to your site. But we can talk about how we can improve that as well. The other thing is performance. Performance is absolutely key, and I think a lot of times people forget about performance when it comes to user experience. Make sure that your website is fast, as fast as physically possible. There's caching plugins out there that'll help you do this. There's page analysis systems like this that'll tell you exactly what's going on. Photon in Jetpack, for example, will speed up your site. Make sure you take performance very seriously, because none of this matters. None of anything that we're talking about matters if it takes seconds for your site to load. But when we talk about ways in which we can speed up that experience, but also maybe you have to sacrifice a visit to your site, we look at AMP, Accelerated Mobile Pages. This is Google's, has anybody been on Google and they notice that they click a news item and it loads instantly, like instantaneously, and you actually kind of notice that you're actually not leaving Google, you're still on Google. So what Google's doing is taking all of your content, caching it into what they call Accelerated Mobile Pages, and then presenting it from the Google servers. So people are not actually visiting your website, but they're improving this and providing, you know, advertising opportunities and other things there for those people to either subscribe to your site or you gain revenue from it. Facebook does it too, it's called Instant Articles, and these are both plugins for WordPress. So you can just download those and get those up and running very quickly. We continue talking about speeding up your site, but Supercache is my favorite caching plugin. I'm biased, it's made by Automattic, the company I work for. There are other great ones out there too, but don't just rely just on your host and assume they're going to give you the fastest performing website ever. Shared hosting, for example, definitely needs some fine tuning. If you go with a managed hosting solution like some of the sponsors out there, they may handle a lot of this for you. But definitely do the page analysis and figure it out. Quick pitch on Photon. Photon's super cool. It's a free image CDN. Does that mean? It means that we serve up all your images from our super fast servers on your behalf. It's a flip of a switch. You don't have to upload anything, configure anything, do anything. And it resizes all of your images live. But if you upload that straight to WordPress and you have nothing like Photon, you're actually giving that to your users every single time they visit your website. So now, because I care about your content and I see it's happening in real time, and I'm on the bus on my way to school or whatever, and I have, you know, 2 gigabytes of data from Verizon every month or whatever, and I download your 4 megabyte photo, you're actually costing me money to visit your website. So what Photon will actually do is resize that image down to the exact size it needs to be for it to be optimized and responsive and have the highest resolution for my phone, and it won't cost me anything extra. If you're interested in learning more about speed, I think there's a talk. That was fun. Alright, I think it's talk tomorrow on performance, but all of these talks are usually recorded and put up on WordPress.tv, so feel free to type in the word faster, and you'll get tons of results of giving talks about performance, and things I guess specifically with WordPress. Cool. I'm going to think about restaurants a lot today. So when we're talking about performance and providing the best possible experience to your users, and you think that you've done everything you need to do because you provided a responsive website that I can see on my phone, maybe you haven't gone far enough. For whatever reason, building a restaurant website is super hard. I don't know why, but people who build restaurant websites or actually ask for them to be built care far more about the huge full screen photo gallery of their food than they care about showing me what time you open or whether or not you take reservations. But we know exactly what restaurant patrons want when they're looking at a restaurant website. Name something. What's something that I want when I visit a restaurant website?
Are you open?
Are you open? Alright. There's hours.
Menu. Phone number.
So the menu. Phone number. And yeah, address. That's all I care about. I probably made a decision based off of something else. Google reviews, Yelp, peers, some special, or word of mouth about whether or not I'm probably going to be someone in your restaurant. But if you pay me $5, I'll look at the other restaurant website tomorrow, but it'll give you exactly what you want. Here's an example. The Chinese restaurant down the street from me. It is a sad image. It's ugly, and you can't even copy and paste this content. But when I arrive at the site, I have the hours, I have the address, I have the phone number, and they take MasterCard. What else do I actually need at that exact moment? Probably, maybe I want to go deeper and go into the menu, and I can actually do that and go to the lunch sessions and house sessions. You've answered all of my questions. This is finishing quickly. This is that opportunity that you have when instead of engagement on your website, which is getting more content than everything else, this is getting them to make a decision and become a loyal customer quicker.
And here's what the menu looks like. No pictures, but still pretty simple.
So I'm going to tell you about an experience I had. This is 1149. This is a restaurant that the after party for WordCamp Rhode Island is going to be at in East Greenwich in September.
That was a nice plug, right?
So my wife and I had a morning to ourselves. For once, our son was being babysat by somebody, I don't know. And we decided, let's go for brunch. We heard that they had brunch. Because of their website, it's responsive. They quickly give me their hours and their address. So I feel like I'm off to a good start. All right, so the menu. So in this instance, I want to know, do you offer brunch? Do you offer exactly what it is my wife and I want. And I click the brunch menu. This is what it does. 7 megabyte PDF is now downloaded to my phone. Has anybody ever tried to work with a PDF on an iPhone? And this is me laying in bed that morning trying to figure out like what we're going to do. And now I'm just So, a responsive website is good. Menu items in the PDF are bad. Now, why do restaurants use PDFs?
Because
it's easy, but it's also because they care so deeply about how we present the food. food, the type. They paid some designer, God knows how much money, to design that menu. And they think it's more important that they show that view on your website than it is just having Times New Roman and just having it at a table. I'll tell you, the latter is actually better for your experience. So anyways, I go back and I say, you know what, all right, so this other menu's here, maybe they just screwed up and they just did something bad. So I click the lunch menu to see if maybe it just took me to another page or something like that. It downloads the same exact PDF over again. The same one, the same PDF had all the menu items on it. So we gave up and we tried to order a breakfast pizza. Why is this app so good? Because it gets me through the process as fast as possible, right? It's not about engagement for them at that moment. It's not about them trying to keep you on the app as long as possible. It's not a game. It's not a blog. It's about getting you through the process as fast as possible. So you need to evaluate the goals of your website and make sure you're analyzing this stuff. Going back, don't forget about accelerated mobile pages. Progressive web apps are really cool too, and there's a plugin for that. It basically turns your website into a mobile app that people can download to their phone, and it keeps it cached. They can even view your website offline. So definitely take a look at progressive web apps too. Alright, we have 4 minutes. Chapter 5, profiling. My buddy Max will recognize this website. It's Max. And I used to work together. Insurance is an interesting field. Nobody likes to work on insurance websites, I can promise you that. But it's actually a lot of fun to be had because you can profile and understand people as they journey through their insurance buying process. How many people in here own a car? Okay, actually more than I thought from Boston. So you need car insurance, right? You have to have it. It's just, it's by law, and if you're not, then you're a criminal and you're a bad person. When you arrive at this website, what else could you possibly need? How many people rent an apartment? How many people own an apartment or a house? So you need homeowner's insurance, renter's insurance, whatever. The list goes on. How many people in here own a boat or an RV or a recreational vehicle of any kind, a jet ski? Jet ski owners? I'm coming over to your house. The point is this, is that they arrive for one reason, right? They arrive for car insurance. But while they're at the site, if you do a good job with your content architecture, you give them an opportunity to understand what else it is that you offer, they may not make a decision on car insurance that day. Or they may only make a decision on car insurance that day. But we actually built a tool that used to recommend additional insurances for you based off of a lot of things, your location, any information that we can gather from you, any information we can gather from the things you were doing on the site before you filled out a form. For example, if you arrive at the site and you put car insurance, I will mark that down and keep track. This individual user at this time, in real time, is looking at car insurance. Then they go visit the boat insurance. They visit something else. We can track all this. Now, there's nothing keeping you from passing that information through the form when they convert. People don't think about this, but you don't have to use forms as an explicit way for users to tell you what they want. You can actually use forms to convert on things that they're interested in based off the information and the actions they were taking on your site. So we had this recommendation engine. I clicked car insurance. It would say, it detected I'm in California. And in certain parts of California, we all recommend earthquake insurance. But if that person was in Minneapolis, I wouldn't recommend earthquake insurance. If they bite and they touch it and they press that button, I pass that through the form. If they leave the recommendation engine and they just go visit the site and they start looking at boat insurance and things like that, what we'd actually do is take that information and pass it through the form when they convert on car insurance, and we would just tell the agent, by the way, they checked out the boat insurance page, they may own a boat now, they may be thinking about owning a boat in the future, it's probably a good idea to talk to them about this. So when you're selling them on car insurance, just mention, hey, just so you know, we offer boat insurance. If you have one now and you need it, great. If not, come back and see us later. So think about that. Think about how you can gather information about users in real time and pass that through to your salespeople or recommendation agents or anything else that you have. Which gets us to the last one, which is suggestions. button, you just press it, you turn on related posts. It does all the work of, you know, tracking the content that you wrote, putting the algorithms, doing all this stuff actually on WordPress.com, so it doesn't have to happen on your servers. You can go talk to those servers, the hosting companies out there, they'll tell you that some related post plugins will be extremely detrimental to their infrastructure. But what we've seen is, you can have this pretty big increase in engagement. And I'll tell you, we have, if you go to the jetpack.com website, there's this article, but there's also another article where we featured the Albuquerque Journal, a newspaper in New Mexico that gets hundreds of thousands of visitors a month. And they were running a different WordPress related post plugin. When they turned on jetpacks, it decreased their infrastructure costs overnight, they saved tons of money, but it also increased their engagement overnight by 4%. So whether it's Jetpack or another plugin, related posts are a great way to keep people focused on your site, and it's super, super easy. But if you want to talk about ways in which you can take it even a step further, clean the slate and start fresh with a brand new website, something like this, you can have your content speak for it, you can have all of your stuff right there, very clear and very easy. You can integrate your social media, this is something else I like to do. So when you're suggesting social accounts as well, you can embed tweets that actually relate to the information that you're writing about. If you go forward, social links, that's good. But here's where related posts can get fun. Related posts in Jetpack or other ones are completely configurable. So instead of having just three little things at the bottom, why not include it as infinite scroll? So you can take the related content that you know is coming up next, and instead of just showing them a little box, just show them the article. And now what you do is you take everything that's on your site, and you're using the infinite scroll system. When you take infinite scroll, related content, put it all together on one page, now the user never has to leave. They have a single, basically, app experience, all recommended stuff in order, and this would be their experience. Now, you tie it to the stuff that we did earlier, with whether they read the content or not, how long it takes to read, all that stuff. You can now not only sort by related content, but you can sort by related content that is unread by that user. How can we get them to relate to the unread content? So if we're using Jetpack, for example, Jetpack makes recommendations, uses the WP query argument to allow you to filter things in and out. So if you have a list of read articles, you would have a post ID for those. And then when you ask for the related content, you can either tell it to exclude those using those post IDs, or you can tell it to sort of at the bottom. So bring everything else up. I'm sorry, I forgot my conclusion slide, but that's okay because we're pretty much... We've got 7 minutes for questions, and I think we're supposed to use the mic there, and I would love to answer your questions, and I kind of cruised through this so we have an opportunity to talk. No questions? Yeah.
Plug in or some kind of app, I love it to do that.
the question was, is there a simple plugin that helps you with GPS and location? You know, that's a great question. I don't know. But if you, it's not much code if you're using HTML5 and a modern browser like Chrome to just request location. It's a few lines of code, and you can use that to tie into. There are plugins for things like the math that goes into deciding how far you are. And there's a whole Google API where you can actually pass latitude and longitude from that, and Google will return that against certain places like how far you are. But I will look into whether or not there's any existing plugins out there, and I'll post it up on the site for these slides.
Too aggressive. Like, I was on a website once looking at, I don't know, office chairs or something, and I literally, as soon as I clicked off the website, got a phone call. Hi, looks like you were just on our site, and it was actually really creepy.
Yeah.
So I wonder, like, how do you make that judgment call?
So I have a great team of people that I work with who have no problem telling me it's creepy. And I suggest creepy things all the time. That doesn't make me creepy just because I get excited about personalization. What I would say is, I think everybody in this room, assuming you're not like a serial killer or something, really you have an idea of what's creepy, right? And it's actually something that's going on right now, and it's happening because it's effective. If any of you purchased a domain or hosting without privacy in like the last month, has anybody done that? And like you had your name and your phone number and all that stuff. Did you get a phone call?
I know that it's my phone. It's a phone call.
Yeah. But this is something that we've been seeing a lot lately, is that people who are purchasing domains, they immediately get a phone call from a company saying, "Would you like help building jesse.com?" And that's super creepy. And it's also spamming. So what I would say is just start simple, start small, and you know, do what makes you feel right. What's happening. Things that aren't creepy that really drive people nuts are like those Amazon ads. So like you look at a backpack and then like for the next 7 websites you visit, that backpack is following you around. And that's so much creepy because people understand it, but people used to think it's creepy. But I think that also comes with education too. A lot of what I strive for is providing the best experience for the students. So the location stuff, they have to agree to share. So it's not like I'm snooping or I'm sitting in the bushes watching them and then telling them where they are. They have to actually agree to it. I think when you're transparent about that stuff, it becomes far less creepy.
You talked about...
Maybe we can take that off and pass it around too. Is that cool?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. You talked about tracking people as they move around the website and passing that through a form. Are there plugins, or is there some area you can go to find code to collect that information, and how do you use that information? How do you pass it through a form?
So, first of all, I should have a disclaimer, and I didn't have it over there. When you do stuff like that, you should definitely have a very clear terms of service on your website, and if you're targeting users in Europe or Germany specifically, there's a lot of stuff that goes into protecting user data and information like that, so you should probably look into that stuff first. But remember the example I gave at the very beginning where the car dealer was just adding parameters to the URLs every single time, so basically it just captured the current parameters, and basically what that is just a question mark, a variable, and a value for that. So you can have something like question mark view equals, and then just add like, numbers for every single page that they visited.
You're talking to a designer.
But basically, I mean, there's a variety of ways to do it. Cookies are easy, adding parameters to the URL. And even if you do the form, sometimes what makes sense is to actually tell them that you're passing it to. So you can say something to them like, you know, based off of you visiting our website, you see that you're interested in car insurance, boat insurance, whatever. But to not get too technical, I mean, you either need to drop it into a cookie so it stays in that session, or you need to keep it up in the headers and the kind of the URL and YouTube parameters. But I can talk to you afterwards if you'd like and kind of go into a little more detail.
Sure.
I think we're done, but I know you had a question.
I was just curious how we can access this problem.
So I'm going to post it. My blog is jesse.blog. So I'm going to post it there. And feel free to subscribe if you can't wait for it, you want it delivered to your email, or whatever. Thank you very much, everybody, for your time.